Not too long ago, we had a preaching course, call it that, where a number of people from various different churches, our church here, the IBC Cologne, ICF in Frankfurt, as well as a church in St. George, Utah, where we have benefited from that and learned how to better, to rightly and effectively proclaim the Word of God. And as a result of that, we have more people who are being trained up and equipped and able to be preaching. And today we get to benefit from that as a church. Today we have CT. Most of us know him as the guy that stands there and plays the guitar. CT is from IBC Cologne. He's a member of the church there and serves the church in Cologne. He is here today, and he will be bringing the word. And CT, why don't you come on up? Just pray for him before he starts. Lord, we're thankful for, well, firstly, Lord, we're thankful for how you are training up and raising up people to preach, to proclaim your word, and to do it well, Lord, in a way that honors and glorifies you, in a way that encourages and challenges us, your church, Lord. We're thankful for that, Lord, and we pray for more of it, Lord. And we also pray for CT as he brings the word today, Lord, that you would give him clarity of mind, Lord, that your spirit would lead him as he proclaims your word to us today. We ask this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Morning, church. It is an honor and privilege to be able to preach the word of God today to you. Next week, you'll be benefiting from Pablo's preaching, I believe from the book of Galatians. So we'll be looking forward to that. But today I'll be preaching from the book of Mark, Mark chapter 7, verses 31 to 37. And while we turn there, in our Bibles or our phones, I'll just quickly give a quick background of the book of Mark. The Gospel of Mark is considered the earliest written gospel. It was written by John Mark. And he was a close companion of the Apostle Peter. So the Apostle Peter is the source of much of what is written in this gospel. The target audience of this gospel is particularly the Gentiles. One of the recurring themes of this gospel is the humanity of the Son of God. And that will be evidenced in the scripture that we are looking at today. So let's read from Mark chapter 7, verses 31 to 37. Could you all please stand with me as we read from Scripture? Mark 7, verse 31 says, "Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went through Sidon to the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. And they brought to him a man who was deaf and had a speech impediment. And they begged him to lay his hand on him. But taking him aside from the crowd privately, he put his fingers into his ears and after spitting, touched his tongue. And looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. And his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. And Jesus charged them to tell no one. But the more he charged them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. And they were astonished beyond measure, saying, he has done all things well. He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak." Let's pray. So Heavenly Father God, we are thankful. We're thankful for this day. We thank you for the time of worship that we have had so far. It is a stark reminder of the world that we are living in, the world that is filled with sin. And Lord, we know that you are the only hope. You are the living hope. And we ask now as we come to your word that you open our hearts, that you open our minds, that as the word is preached, Lord, that we will be open, we will be teachable, our hearts will come towards you. Pray that you will be with me as I preach this word and to everyone in the audience who's listening as well. Pray pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Right, so this account that was just read to you is actually only mentioned in the Gospel of Mark. And you find that there are no other parallels in any other of the Gospels. You are currently, as a church, before this break that Pastor Stephen went on, you are in the book of Matthew, and you are in Matthew 14, right, the last time we left off. And this actually, there's a parallel in Matthew 15, which just mentions generally how Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee and healing many, resulting in them glorifying the God of Israel. So that's about the same time this happens. So the main point that I'm presenting to you today is that Jesus is for all. Jesus is for all. And by that, I mean that Jesus is for all places, all people, and all problems. All places, all people, and all problems. So we're going to repeat that at the end of this. So my aim will be to go through this 3 points and show you how this is described in this text. There will be some overlaps, obviously, because since we know that places are consisted of people, and people in turn have their individual problems, right? So where is this in the book of Mark? If you look back and front, this text is sandwiched between the demonstration of the Syrophoenician woman's faith. If you remember that woman who brought her daughter to be healed because she was a demon-possessed child, and the feeding of the 4,000. That's something we know very well. That will actually be the second time Jesus feeds a multitude, the first being the feeding of the 5,000, which is in Mark 6, one chapter before this. So this brings us to the first point, which is Jesus is for all places. So this is a turning point in Jesus' ministry in terms of geography and the group of people that it is ministering to. Jesus is also actually really deliberately going to these places which are predominantly Gentile. So his ministry of this Syrophoenician woman was in the region of Tyre and Sidon. If you know where Tyre and Sidon is, it is where modern-day Lebanon is. So that's where Tyre and Sidon is. And the feeding of the 4,000 also takes place in a Gentile area. So it's near the Sea of Galilee. And in the initial part of Jesus' ministry, he was actually focused more on the Jewish areas around the Sea of Galilee, with his home base, as you all know, being in the town of Capernaum, the village, right? Because Capernaum is a village. So this indicates a shift in his focus. So looking again at the text, if you look at verse 31, it tells us that Jesus then makes his way back down to the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. So the Decapolis was a group of 10 cities, as the Greek name suggests, Deca for 10, Polis for city. And these cities are located on the eastern frontier of the Roman Empire, right? These cities were dependent on Rome, and they were centers of Greek and Roman culture. They are very Gentile, so these cities here. So the surrounding cities in the region was otherwise populated by people who spoke languages such as Hebrew, Aramaic, Phoenician, or Arabic, right? So according to Pliny's work, Natural History, the Decapolis consisted mostly of cities which are present in, which are located in present-day Jordan. But there are also a couple of cities in Israel and Syria, Skytopolis, Damascus, for example. So what does this, all these places, you know, I've mentioned quite a few places, so what does this verse tell about Jesus? His ministry was for all people, all places, sorry. It did not matter that geographically and culturally speaking, this deaf man, as well as the Syrophoenician woman before him, was from a Gentile region. Jesus did not consider the land that was outside of the Jewish borders to be unworthy of his message or his healing, right? He did not consider that one would have to come from a specific tribe or nation or speak a particular language before he can approach them. And if you consider the distances he traveled at this time to get to his destination, it was not easy at all. If you think about it, modern-day Lebanon all the way to Israel. So if you stretch a measure, let's say you have a ruler and you stretch it across from Sidon to the Sea of Galilee to the city of Decapolis, that would be about 90 kilometers. But we also know that's not how people travel, right? You will be traveling around mountain ranges and paths that are suitable for people to walk. So that would be actually be closer to 150 to 160 kilometers. So the total distance that is being covered here. And so you can estimate that people of that day could travel about 30 kilometers a day. So that was about 5 to 6 days, just one way, right? So that would be, that's a really long distance, isn't it? And I could think of an example where I love hiking myself, and I think in about March this year, me and my wife, we went hiking on this place called the Wasserroute in Altenberg, and that was about 15 to 16 kilometers, right? So we are keeping a very brisk pace, we were walking fast, and we did that in about 3.5 hours. Partly also because we had an appointment to attend to later on that day. But we really pushed it. And by the end of that hike, well, we were done. We were done. Our legs were sore. And and this was done with proper hiking shoes and signs all around telling you where to go, right? So you can imagine the situation of that day in Jesus' time. It was not easy at all. It was no mean feat to travel that kind of distance. But this proves to be no obstacle for Jesus and his ministry of the people. So thus telling us that Jesus is for all places. Now, moving on to my next points, which are Jesus is for all people and all problems. I'm going to put that together. So let's consider this man, right? This deaf man. Verse 32 tells us he was a man who was deaf and had a speech impediment. The text does not tell us if this man had this condition from birth or it was a more recent thing. However, at the very basic level, as well as being a Gentile, this man had physical disabilities, which at the very least made him unable to communicate and understand people effectively. And you think about it, communication is such a vital part of being a human being, right? We have been so limited by the pandemic, you know, in terms of how we can meet up, how many people can meet up together at one time. We have to speak with masks on, but imagine on top of that, you can't even hear, you can't even speak. So this man was faced with that kind of, you know, disability, this kind of thing which was holding him back from communicating. And if we had that, that would really affect us severely, I would think. So we can imagine how frustrating it was for this man to live from day to day, to express merely his needs, his emotions, would be such a huge task for this man. The description speech impediment does suggest that he could actually produce some sort of sound, but it was not understandable by the people around him. So in modern times, we can see how deaf people can actually be trained through speech therapy that takes many years, but they could eventually produce some sort of sound that could be understood by the people around them. But the people of that time, the deaf people of the time, their main modes of communication would be through lip reading and sign language. So sign language existed back then. One of the earliest records of sign language was in the 5th century BC. So it was before what happened right here. Right, so this was mentioned in Plato's dialogue about these deaf people communicating through sign language. So just as lepers were outcasts of the society of the day, you see a very similar attitude towards deaf and mute people of that time. So people who had disabilities such as deafness, muteness, blindness, and paralysis, they were considered cursed. Or even that their parents committed some sort of sin. So this was brought upon them. Since their physical condition led people to believe that they were cursed, they would be shunned to the fringes of the society. They were perhaps not kicked out of the city and forced to live in an enclosed area just as lepers were, but they were treated with a sort of disdain and they were forced to fend for themselves. And in many cases, they were forced to beg as well for their livelihood. But how does Jesus respond to this deaf man? Let's look at verse 33. And taking him aside from the crowd privately, Let's just stop there for a second. Jesus welcomes this person by taking him aside to minister to him personally. So it speaks volumes that Jesus does not just perform this miracle like a magician would wave his wand and then on to the next person, right? He actually takes him to the side personally. And his approach is very personal, very specific to this very person. And he treats him with a sort of care that even the people who brought the deaf man to him did not expect that from him. If you look in verse 32, it tells us that all they were asking him to do was to lay his hands on him. That was all he said. But Jesus goes far and beyond that. And what happened next is absolutely astonishing. The second part of verse 33 tells us, he put his fingers into his ears and after spitting, touched his tongue. And looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, Ephphatha, that is, be open. So, on first glance, what Jesus does seems a bit strange and might even be a bit disgusting for some, right? This act of spitting, right? Now, we know that this man is deaf and he has a speech impediment. However, he still, what does he still have? He still has his sight. He has his sense of touch. So, what we are seeing here is a very deliberate way for Jesus to communicate with this deaf man. First, he puts his fingers into his ears, so indicating clearly to the man, you know, that he knew the situation, that is his deafness. He then goes on to spit, touch his tongue, addressing his second disability, that is his speech impediment. Does anybody here know sign language? You know some sign language a little bit? Okay. Right, so do you know the variation of the word listen or hear? Yeah, very good. She knows it. So one of them is this one right here, which is to cup your ears. And the second one, the variation, is this one right here. And that's what Jesus was doing. That's exactly what he was doing. So this was very, the man understood what he was doing. As a final gesture, he lets out a deep sigh and looking up to heaven, says to him in Aramaic, Ephphatha. That is explained by the writer as meaning be open. So why do I say deep sigh? It doesn't say deep in the text, right? The Greek word used for sigh is stenazo. And the other way you see it used in the Bible is, for example, in Romans 8, verse 23, where it talks about all those who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly. So this word groan as we wait for adoption. So this deaf man, he's looking on as Jesus empathizes with him, sighing or groaning as his eyes can see. You can even imagine Jesus breathing in and his chest rising and falling as he sighs. You know, this very characteristic movement when you do the sighing, right? So he sees this and this gesture is unmistakable. We can also imagine him being able to see Jesus' lips as he enunciates the syllables to the word Ephphatha. So this is not a common word for sure. And the enunciation of these words requires a very unique movement of your lips and tongue. Here you see Jesus addressing this unfortunate man in a very personal and powerful way. The text also says he looks up to heaven. Here there is no doubt where the power to heal comes from. So a side note here, this verse again reinforces the point that the Gospel of Mark was written for non-Aramaic speaking Gentiles. Aramaic words such as Ephphatha in this case and Talita Kumi in another are translated by Mark. This shows that the audience does not have a grasp of this language and Mark has to make it understandable. So let's go back to the sermon. And what happens next? The text says in verse 35, and his ears were open, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. So what happens here is instantaneous. It demonstrates the power of Jesus' healing. There is an immediacy about it. There is no periods of months or years spent on speech therapy, a slow recovery, having to relearn the language, but right away, this deaf man, he could hear and he could speak plainly. In the original Greek, the word leo for released gives us a picture of a knot, you know, being untied. The King James Version translates it as the string of his tongue was loosed. So it leaves us in no doubt that it was as if there was a knot that was holding his tongue. It was unfastened, and then he began to speak straightly and correctly. So the last part of the passage tells us that Jesus then forbids the people present to spread the word about the miracle that he performed. But what did they do? They went ahead and did it anyway, right? We see this happening very often throughout his early ministry, where he actually asked those he healed or those who were with them not to tell anyone else. But the sheer amazement, really, and wonder that these people experience from these miracles and healings makes them unable to contain their words. And even as the text says, proclaim it even more zealously. Do you ever wonder why Jesus told the people not to tell others? This is not the main point of this text, but I'll try to address this in a very concise manner. The two keywords are focus and timing. Focus and timing. The miracles confirmed his authenticity, and they were for pointing people towards him, but he didn't want the miracles to be the main focus. He didn't want the people's attention to be distracted from the ministry of the word, which was of repentance and of faith. So we also find out in the earlier chapter in Mark 1, verse 45, that it actually hindered Jesus from openly entering a town. As people were coming to him from all sorts of places, everybody wanted to be touched, everybody wanted to be healed, right? So we come to the point of the sermon where we talk about the implications and the application of this text. So here we are. Jesus is for all. All places, all people, and all problems. This Jesus, who is for all places, people, and problems, is also for all time, even today. It is as simple as this. Jesus is not for a specific type of people who speak in a certain way, have a certain cultural and educational standing, or even in this case, have access to all the physical functions, right? So Jesus is for all. He traveled far from the Sea of Galilee to minister to the people of Tyre and Sidon, and he made the long trip back to the Galilean side of Decapolis. It didn't matter that this man was a Gentile. It didn't matter that he was limited by his disabilities to communicate properly. It didn't matter that this man was not exactly the person with the highest standing in terms of societal rank. Jesus dealt with this man in a way which was so loving and so caring. He communicated to him in a way only he could understand. His approach was purposeful and meaningful through his use of gestures with his hands, his body language, his enunciation even. In the same way, Jesus communicates to each one of us, each one of every single person that is here today. In the same way, he deals with us personally, very specifically as well, right? And further on, it is vital that we do not limit Jesus' ability to save and to work in the lives of those who love him. From a human point of view, sometimes it's very easy to dismiss a person based on their background or their current situation, right? Let me tell you this, where we come from and what we did in the past does not determine our worthiness of being in the family of God and the reach of his transforming power. Sometimes we find ourselves discouraged. We might even have this sneaky doubt in our minds that the situation is too big, even for God. But this text actually tells us that we can be confident in Jesus. I was just reminded when I looked over here to Thomas about this, what he was talking about, Jesus being the cornerstone. And this is a cornerstone, a stone that we can rely on. He's a solid rock, right? And Jesus, he firstly overcomes the barriers that are not just physical, But Jesus also breaks through any mental and spiritual barriers. But firstly, if we give him the chance, right? He can transform us, but it first requires a heart that is humble and teachable, willing to let go of pride and the things that so often keep us away from God. Believer, you can go to God today, right here, right now. This is a God who is accessible, who is there for you through all your trials and tribulations. As you go through times of happiness, as you go through times of sadness, too many professing Christians live nowadays as if they do not have a God. You compartmentalize your life into parts which you say, you know, God, you can take care of this part, but this one right here, I'm in charge. I'm strong enough for this. I'll take care of this. That is pride. And that is the root of sin. Let me just repeat that one more time. Pride is the root of sin. That is the question. Are you willing to lay down your problems and sins down at the feet of God? He promises us in his word that he in his tender mercies would lead us along life, the choppy waters of life. 1 John 1:9 tells us, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Also, it is important that we do not play the part of God and actually determine who deserves to be saved. We may find ourselves saying, you know, that person is such a nasty character, they don't deserve this, or, you know, that person is beyond repair. Their words and actions show something which is completely disregarding God, but that actually limits God in that our own moral compass comes and defines who God can save, right? Do you believe that Jesus is for all people? Do you believe that he can save anyone? We think of many examples of people who actually lived the degenerate life and then they were actually persecuting the church of God, and then later on in life, they became, you know, they came to trust and believe in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. We think of the example of the Apostle Paul, a very famous example. He was persecuting the church of God in this zealousness, but he ends up being this exemplary servant and one who brought the gospel to far-reaching places, right? So God has a plan to bring his own sheep into his flock. He does not, and he will not give up until this has come to pass. He reaches even to the farthest nations and the most unexpected people, as we can see in this text right here. What Jesus did and how he acted shows the character of God, his tender mercies, and it gives us a picture of how he welcomes his sheep, in that he deals with each one of us in a very personal and specific manner. And finally, I would like to address the people in the audience, you might be listening online as well, who do not believe in Jesus as Lord. Is this your first time hearing the gospel? Or perhaps you've heard the gospel before, but there have been questions in your mind about what it means to actually follow Jesus. We are more than happy to talk to you about that, to explain to you the good news of the coming of Jesus Christ, his death on the cross for our sins and his resurrection 3 days after that, conquering sin and death. Jesus came to the world to die for sinners. He displays God's perfect mercies, his perfect patience, and those who believe in him have eternal life. If you don't believe in him, do not wait any longer. If God is calling out to you today, my prayer is that you will step out and receive him as your Lord and Savior. Today is the day of salvation. Jesus says in Revelation, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and sup with him and he with me." The Bible also says, "All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Listen to his voice today and respond. So before we close off, I would like to read the words to the hymn, "Just As I Am," written by Charlotte Elliott in 1835. So personally speaking, this is one of my favorite hymns. There is a truth about these words that were penned those many years ago. These words ring true to the very core. It is still as relevant today as it was when it was first written. This hymn just beautifully just lays out the fact that Jesus is for all. All people, all places, all problems. The call of God is simple. We are not asked to attain to a certain goal standard. We are not asked to reach an impossible goal before we can approach Him. We come just as we are. And then He begins the great work in us. So here are a few stanzas of a poem. Just as I am, though tossed about, with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, poor, wretched, blind, sight, riches, healing of the mind, yet all I need in Thee to find, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, Thou wilt receive, will welcome, pardon, cleanse, relief. Because Thy promise, I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for Your word today. We thank You for the power of Your word. And we ask now as the people who are listening to this text, that they would head towards You just as they are, that they will not hold back, Lord. That You are a God who is loving. You are a God who has patience. And we see all those characteristics, Lord. You touched this deaf man with such love, Lord. How personal it was as You spoke to him, as You communicated with him in a way only he could understand. I ask that You work in the lives of the people who are here today, that You speak to them in a way only they can understand, and that they in turn will walk towards You, Lord, that they will come to You just as they are. We thank You so much for today. We ask that You continue being by our sides as we live this week under Your grace, Lord. In Your name we pray. Amen.
Well, hello there. I'm Stephen, pastor of International Baptist Church here in Bonn, Germany. Thank you so much for joining us. I pray that you were blessed by the Word of God today and that you will join us again next week right here on our YouTube channel.